Hello everybody, and welcome back to Hell Revealed. This is going to be the last part. For the last 25 parts, I have been playing through the game, and the time has come to put my headphones down and to give a long and detailed review of what I have experienced. So, this is the last footage of Hell Revealed. As you can see, this is the end screen. This is the screen which you get after you beat map 30. As you can see, this is probably custom made. And as you can see, the creators of this megawad had some artistic capabilities, or at least they were able to use some contemporary art tools on their computers. So this is Hell Revealed, and that's a picture of two people. I don't necessarily believe that those are real depictions, but they probably encompass the two people who created this megawad. One of them is Hage Niv, and another is Jonathan Donner. And also, just to mention, the creator of Serious Sam Weapon Mod was and is named Bazooka. So these are the three people who are responsible for all of this playthrough. They created the material which you saw in each of the video which I displayed to you. So now I probably will go a little bit out of order because this probably will be a long video. So the first thing is to showcase all the monsters. I'm not sure if you have played Doom 2 before. The chances are that you probably have, but anyways, this is a great opportunity to look at all the monsters which we met in Hell Revealed and to discuss how they affected the game. So the first one is Zombie Man. Basically, I don't remember much of him. I guess there were a couple packs of them. Basically, in map 1, teleporter room near the end. When I believe the next sighting was in map 3, the dumpster. In that particular map, in that area, I would jump on that rocket secret, and below, in the area below, that deep down, there would be kind of place with a lot of zombie men. And out of my top of head, it's basically all the tough encounters, including zombie men. There was one kind of tough encounter with zombie men in map 21, Siege. But in that particular map, you would only face one zombie man, and the deal was that if you kill him, you will alert a lot of monsters to attack you. So we are going forward. This is a shotgun guy. Again, I don't remember having much interaction with this guy. If there was any interaction, it was basically very, very one-sided. I would just simply exterminate these guys. I guess I remember facing them in map 1, in the opening area, in the teleporter room. And the next memorable sighting with them was in map 9, where I would fight huge groups of shotgun guys in a map called The Jail. I guess they were supposed to be prison keepers. So now we are moving forward. Heavy weapon dude. Basically, I was pretty impressed that the number of them wasn't as high as one could possibly anticipate. Because these guys are probably the most popular hit scanner enemies. For example, if you have played map sets like Plutonia, you would probably run into a lot of more encounters of heavy weapon dude, or as I call them, a chain gunner. The most notable encounter with them was, I believe, map 17, if I'm correct, its name was Black Tower. So overall, oh yes, I remember there was map 23, Ascending the Stars, and in that map, you would simply descend into a room. You descend into a room, and like you are on a descending platform, like it feels like a box, like a lift, and you're going down into a room, And in that room, all around you are these chain gunners, and they just simply shoot you to death. Like, that's one of those places where there was actually for some attempts considering cheating, because, well, you just pop into that room, these chain gunners open fire, and you're dead the next second. So even through the encounters weren't as frequent, whenever you will meet them, it probably will be pain. And I guess another encounter with these heavy weapon dudes was map 13, I believe. Last look at Eden, and that was basically a massacre of these guys. So if most of the time these guys aren't much of a challenge unless they placed in a huge number all around you with no ability to dodge them. So now we are moving forward. Imp. Oh yeah, look at him. He's so tough. And actually, this little imp was one of my boss encounters in map 29. That map was called the Temple of Fear. Look at this guy. Look at this little. He had his red eyes. Big gaping mouth. He's definitely ready to kill him, us, like to kill the players. Like he's afraid of nothing. Basically, it was the default basic monster. And my memorable encounters with him was, I believe, map 8 knockout, possibly the most challenging encounter with these imps. Where I would basically have to kill a lot of them. Like it was triple digits. So it was like some scenario of defend your base. Like you have an arena, you have a room with a door. You are in a room with a door. You open the door. You grab the key in that arena, and the imps they start swarming you. They start going for you. Like there are four teleporters in the room, and those imps, they get inside and they start going at you. Of course, you have a vulnerability, but it is only 30 seconds of safety, and they just keep coming at you. They're not stopping. And also that map that basically doesn't have much ammo at all, so it was a very memorable encounter with imps. The next encounter, which I kind of remember, is map 15. In that place, basically all the imps died. Spoiler, because there was an arena, and around the arena, like in the shape of a circle, was a ledge, and on that ledge there was a mass of imps. Watch that part. Basically, I was just started running around in circles, and I just kept killing these guys. But and it was actually a little bit boring for me, so I started singing. And there was like a huge number of these imps, but they were unable to do any harm. And I guess this is kind of a team with Hell Revealed. They like to put you versus a lot of monsters. But it's not quite enough because it's a thing like there's an arena and there's a specific amount of space in that arena. So the idea is that it will be pretty difficult to go around these monsters because these monsters, what we do, they throw a fireball at you and it just goes a straight line where you are supposed to be. So if you are straight running around them, they're basically unable to do any harm to you. So if the room is not big enough, you'll be able to run around all these monsters, and suddenly, all the challenge of fighting all these masses of imps becomes near next to zero. Like, I think, for example, Math 33, Ascending the Stars, for example, that start, there was also a big imp encounter, but at that point, I was not only able to kind of run around them, but also because I came from previous levels, I had a lot of ammo. I had a lot of powerful weapons, and these guys, they simply don't have that much hit points. So, if you want to do a spam of imps correctly, you need to make sure that it's a huge amount of them. Like, if a player has a lot of weapons, you need to consider what the. These imps will go down quicker than a slice of butter, like in the sunlight. So these imps weren't very memorable, except for a part in map 8. And other than that, they were generally a pushover. And sometimes I just enjoyed looking at them because, well, they provide some comedic entertainment because you are overpowered, you are in supposedly difficult map. It's supposedly one of the most famous megawatts of all time, and you face these guys. So you look at them, oh my, I'm so intimidated by this guy. Okay, moving forward. Okay, what you are seeing now is a demon. Oh, he's a tough man. Tough, tough. But in order for him to do any damage for you, basically need to get up close and personal. So, because basically Doom guy has a lot of mobility, well, these guys apparently are not capable to do as much damage as we could. And from my memory, playing through Hell Revealed, I didn't encounter these guys frequently, and whenever I would encounter one of these, they wouldn't pack much challenge. Like for example, map 29, Temple of Fear, you start in a corridor and there are a ton of these demons behind you. You start going forward and the platform rises up and these demons, like a swarm, they start following you all around the level. The idea is, if you are fast enough, you will simply outrun these demons and will get to the next part of the level. And because AI in Doom isn't that great, these demons will get stuck in the level architecture, will basically get lost. Because they are moving in the direction of a player, but they do not consider that there are obstacles in front of them. Like for example, there might be a huge wall in between us, but the demon knows where I am and is tries to go through the wall. So basically, the demons were greatly misused in Hell Reveal. I basically, maybe in map 17, I remember there was one room where you would pick up some item and a mass of demons would spawn in. It was a very small room, so there was potential to have a challenging battle, but basically the door was not closed. You basically could just open it and leave the room, so that's all the challenge. Like, there's no challenge considering demons. Now, I guess there was no showcase of specters, but they are more of the same. I basically don't remember them being put to any good use either. Like Spectre is supposed to be hard to see. It's supposed to be translucent, but there were barely any dark rooms with specters in this megawad. Now this is Lost Soul. Again, one little Lost Soul is not much of a challenge. But it's still tougher than a demon because it can fly and it can hit you at a much faster rate. And it's also like an environmental damage, because if you are using a rocket launcher and the rocket collides with a Lost Soul flying towards you, the rocket explodes and you might take some damage back to yourself. But basically, I do not remember any good encounters with Lost Souls in particular, but I will go to that other part, because Lost Soul does not frequently come on its own. It usually has its big mama, the pain elemental, and we'll come to it soon. Okay, moving forward, Kaka Demon. Again, he looks very cute, and in reality, well, Kaka Demons aren't very capable of doing much harm to you. I'm trying to remember any encounters where I would fear for my life while facing these Kaka Demons, and I don't really remember having much difficulty with them. Perhaps map 14 comes to my mind, City in the Clouds, I believe the name is, where you would go into a rocket launcher room, if I remember correctly, and the wall closes, and a lot of cock-up demons just spawn in. And you have to kill them very quickly. But if you are fast enough, you can just run to that wall, which has risen, press the switch, lower it down, and exit the room. And also, that map had a lot of invulnerabilities. I believe at least 2 invulnerability items, if I'm correct. So basically, those Kaka Demons could have been dealt very, very easily with. So, like for example, when you put Kaka Demons to the map, they are supposed to extract some difficulty through the fact that they can fly around, but that simply wasn't the case. There was a lot of missed opportunities to put Kaka Demons on, because yes, they just throw one little projectile at you, and you can dodge it, and there's another monster who throws just one single projectile, and that's Hell Knight, and he's a tougher version, the Baron of Hell. So I believe the creators of this megawad, they really thought, well, Kakademon throws one projectile, he's slow, has less hit points, so it's just a mid-tier monster which we can ignore. And as a result, they basically went for Hell Baron approach. So basically, we were facing a lot of Hell Barons, which I guess I don't in particular mind that mindset, but the result was that there wasn't very much variety with these monsters. Like, for example, if I would be seeing more Kakademons flying around, it would be much more fun to play through some of the levels, because some of the levels, they really got grind. Like, a lot of grinding was involved in them, and a lot of it was thanks to the Barons of Hell, because they are like underground imps. They throw at you one projectile, and even through that projectile is tough. It can hurt you very bad indeed. But you can just run around it. So what's the point of the damage of a projectile if you can just avoid it all the time? So that was the problem with the Barons of Hell. Let's see who's next. Yeah, here it is, Hell Knight. Even way they aren't used as frequently as I would have liked it. It's that way with the creators of this megawad, which simply put more barons. And I guess it was like, if you put more Hell Knights, you would see more colors. It's like the map would be more enjoyable to play, like, if you would see more variety. I guess taking a baron down would take more ammo. Maybe it would be harder, but you need to keep in mind that you can put two Hell Knights. Two Hell Knights have the same hit points as a Baron of Hell. So basically, two Hell Knights mean twice as many projectiles flown at you, and twice as much room. So basically, for the same amount of ammo required, for the same amount of grinding, you make a room twice as populated, and you increase the projectile amount by twice. So it was using Hell Knights was probably a good idea. Well, unfortunately, they weren't utilized frequently. But if Hell Revealed creators didn't want to push their creation too much into grinding, I could have considered replacing Baron of Hell with a spam of Hell Knights, and it would have been much quicker to deal with, and probably much more challenging too. Okay, we are moving forward. Oh, here we go, Baron of Hell. That is in one infamous creature, was supposed to be a boss in original Doom, but well, in my experience, he was basically a laughing stock in all the maps which I faced him to. I guess the one saving grace for him was in map 17, the entering area, because there was a lot of these Barons of Hell, and they were supported by Revenants and by Chain Gunners. So in that specific arena, you was actually in danger of being surrounded by the Barons of Hell. So actually, for one single map, for one single situation, you would actually be afraid of these guys. You would be afraid that they could come and harm you. Okay, now moving the next. Arachnotron. Well, I don't remember them being used very frequently. I did enjoy the specific map, Arachnophobia. It was map 7, where would you need to kill a lot of these Arachnotrons at once. And it was a pretty fun battle. These guys tend to throw a lot of projectiles at you, so basically, you can turn it in a sort of a bullet hell, where you just make sure that there isn't much cover, and we make sure that there's a lot of arachnotrons to deal with, and in that case, you could have some fun through bullet hell scenario. But most of Hell Revealed, they were underused, and their potential was used to a very minimum. Like, it's a fun monster to deal with, but basically, I don't remember facing them very frequently, not frequently enough as I would like them to. Because now I really try to think hard. Where did I see these guys? Where did I see these guys? And to my mind, it comes map 7, Arachnophobia, and then what it is, map 9, I believe, the jail, where you fought one single Arachnotron. And after that, yeah, like, there's a lot of clouds over my head. Like, where did I see Arachnotrons? Where did I see them? Oh, come on, remember. It seems like in Hell Revealed, these guys were pretty extinct, basically. And that's a great missed opportunity because they provide a lot of projectiles to dodge, and they really could become a challenge to deal with. And yes, now I remember. Map 14, City in the Clouds, where there were a bunch of Arachnotrons put on the ledge, but basically, they were unable to chase you. You were able to dodge them, so that's not a challenge. Like Hell Revealed, as I probably have said, has a problem that gives way too much room to dodge these monsters, and that really makes the encounters less challenging and less fun as a result. Okay, moving forward. Okay, Pain Elemental. Whenever I would run into these guys, it probably would be a standout moment in any level. Basically, the most fun I had with them was Map 24. It was post-mortem, and it was a very difficult level overall. Maybe a little bit grindy, like I have some complaints regarding that level, but like encounters with Pain Elemental in that map were outstanding, they were great! Basically, it was like a chasm-like huge arena. Like, it has some huge rocks in the middle of it which block the view, and those rocks open up, and these Pain Elementals will just flow out to attack you. And then soon, very soon, like within seconds, all the room, all the arena would be full with lost souls. And because the number of Pain Elementals would be so great, it would be like one-time attack where you need to rush to kill them. And you would also need to deal with lost souls because they would form some sort of a shield. You would need to kill the Pain Elementals as quickly as possible, and there would be tons of them. If you watch my particular part, you would see that there would be one Pain Elemental coming at me after another. Like there was, I don't know, maybe even 50 Pain Elementals in the map. And there was, of course, the level provided some teleporters, some cover. Maybe not enough cover to deal professionally with these lost souls, but basically it was like a cat and a mouse scenario. Like one part of arena gets overcrowded with Pain Elementals. When you go, you jump into teleporter, you move to our area, and you try to hold yourself out in that particular place. And that's like one great opportunity to use Pain Elementals efficiently because in most other levels, we have some Pain Elementals, but they weren't used as efficiently. Like, I remember I fought four Pain Elementals probably in map 19. Everything dies, that level. And that was, I guess, okay. But the other fight, which I really didn't enjoy at all, was four Pain Elementals fought in map 13, like last look at the Eden. Basically, you just go to a place. It's like a green circle of grass. In the middle of it, it's a platform. It's defended by Kyberdemon. You kill that guy, and you go and take the key from a Kyberdemon. And what happens? Four Pain Elementals spawn in. But there's a huge problem. That green circle of grass, that particular area, it's basically an impassable line, like monsters cannot leave it. So what I could have done, I could have simply walked out of a circle, and Pain Elementals couldn't do a thing. They could, yes, they would spawn a lot of lost souls, but they couldn't leave a circle because of that line. I guess the only issue then could be that the game would get too laggy as Pain Elementals would produce too many lost souls, but in that particular case, I think I stayed in the circle and just killed all the Pain Elementals with a chainsaw. And it was pretty fun because if you are too close to Pain Elemental, it cannot harm you. It attempts to spawn a lost soul, but because you stand in the place where lost soul would materialize, you basically lost soul doesn't spawn, so Pain Elemental is defenseless and you can kill him with a chainsaw. Okay, moving forward. Oh, Revenant! Like, these guys have a lot of potential. Basically, you need to make sure that what they do is they shoot at you a projectile, and that projectile starts to follow you. You might think, wow, maybe it's hard to dodge a homing projectile, but if you have enough room to walk around these guys, it's not really a problem, because in a lot of cases where I would deal with spam of remnants, what happened? All the projectiles would simply start following me, and they would just join together. Like, it would give a birth to one huge super projectile, and it would be very red, very glowing, and it would follow me through all the level, basically. And it's as long as I'm moving, I'm not able to be hit by them. So the problem is, but if we want to make Revenants challenging, we need to make scenarios where it would become difficult to simply outrun the projectile, and frequently that was not an issue. I think the most challenging that Revenants were, that was map 32, mostly harmful, where you just go to the first door, you open it, and there's hundreds of these Revenants waiting behind the door, and they just start flowing into your room. And basically, yes, you can dodge a couple of Revenants in that room easily, but when you are dealing with dozens of them, it actually becomes challenging. It's like a time attack when the Revenants are flooding through the door, and you need to make sure that they are not flooding in too quickly. And in the meantime, you need to deal with all these projectiles, and if you try to dodge the projectiles, if you try to hide behind the wall, in the meantime, the room will be flooded with even more Revenants. So it was a pretty good use for the Revenants in that particular map. Okay, going forward, Mancubi. Well, I had some fun with them, but I also had some poor experiences with them. Basically, if you watch my map 24 playthrough, in that playthrough there were two pillars, and on those two pillars there were two Mancubi. You kill one Mancubi, that Mancubi respawns, and that was I don't know, on those two pillars I killed a total of 50 Mancubi maybe. They just were respawning again and again and again. And there was not really much challenge because you could dodge them. I guess one of the challenge was that if you would focus on one pillar, you focus on the Mancubi, you try to kill him, you try to make him dead. But when in the meantime, the other Mancubi on the other pillar shoots at you and hits you, because you thought you kill him, but that Mancubi just keeps respawning. So, but if you don't get greedy, if you kill this Mancubi with patience, there was no challenge on that particular map from a Mancubi. I also like the Mancubi charge at you on map 13. Last look at Eden. That room where you go down to that area where there be a lot of Changuners spawn, and then the next huge a garden or something, there's roads, and there's a ton of Mancubi, and they start running towards you, they start going towards you, and there's a lot of them. So basically it's a scenario defend your base. You were in a safe room, but the amount of Mancubi was so huge that you would need to make sure to kill them quick enough that they wouldn't enter your room. And because the amount of Mancubi was so huge, you needed to be very quickly, and you also needed to make sure that you dodge the projectiles and which have some heavy firepower. So that was a good use of the Mancubi. Other than that, I had some fun with them on map 14, where I was sitting in the clouds. We have a lot of roads, a lot of buildings, and roads naturally around the buildings. And there was plenty of Mancubi around. And you would just go through these streets, and you would need to be careful because you never know when Mancubi starts shooting a projectile at you. It's kind of difficult to dodge it. For example, you are in a huge street. There's no good ways to leave it very quickly. And it's very long, and somewhere very, very distant, somewhere very, very far, a Mancubi shows up. You don't see him at once, because he's far away. And in the meantime, you just kill some monsters near you, and then you just feel it, in your back, a huge, huge pain. And you realize, Mancubi sniped you. It started sniping you, and then it becomes really difficult to escape the street, because this Mancubi can attack you very, very aggressively. Other than that, when I think about this Mancubi, a lot of the cases of them being used, it was like Arachnatron. They put them on some platform, they become Mancubi stationary turrets. And that greatly diminishes the potential of the monster, because if there's a turret, can simply hide from it. You can simply hide behind some structure. You can simply run around. Because a lot of monsters in the Doom are based over projectiles, and projectiles can be easily avoided. So what you need to make sure that it's impossible to efficiently strafe run around them, or otherwise the difficulty just goes away. And in the Hell Revealed, a lot of cases where that these fat monsters would be used as the turrets, and the freely moving monsters most of the time would be something like Hell Barons. And that combination would simply be a kind of a chore to deal with. Okay, moving forward. Archvile. Well, they are fun. They can be quite challenging. Trying to remember where I faced them. And they would be used in Hell Revealed, but they were used with moderation. There was no unfair Archvile spam for me. Like, for example, there's a ton of dead monsters. No way to escape the room, like a very little cover, and a ton of archvile starts spawning into the room. Thankfully, in Hell Revealed, that wasn't the case. The biggest spam of archviles I faced was in map 24. But in that case, all the archviles would be on the ledge, up ahead. They couldn't go down to you, and you would have plenty of room to avoid them, like to walk away from a site. So basically, I guess archvites could be used more popularly because often the map creator would play them very safely. So you just like one archvite, a two archvite, you just kill them very quickly, and that's all. Because I remember one, it was supposed to be a boss battle of sorts, like in map 31, the descent. You just go down into the area, like in the dungeons, and you go pick a key. All the monsters are dead. And what happens is that two archviles spawn in. Like two guys in an empty room with some dead monsters. Yes, the idea is that they resurrect everything. But considering that at that point you have a lot of powerful ammunition, you can just blast these archviles very, very quickly, and all the challenge is simply gone. We could have went with more archviles on that particular level, considering that there were some passable lines for monsters. And there was plenty of room to go around the archvile spam, and that was like a missed opportunity. And for the most part, these archviles were really, really underused, because even now I'm trying to think where they would be used as a threat. Maybe in the very, very last level, map 30, yes, there were some archviles which you needed to kill very quickly, or otherwise you wouldn't be able to kill Romero's head. But other than that, I'm really struggling to remember a scenario where I would face archvile and I would feel threatened by it. Most of the time, they have either limited mobility or limited ability to resurrect monsters, or the cover is simply too much of a cover for you to hide behind. Okay, we are moving forward. We have a big, big, ugly spider mastermind. Again, I don't remember facing them frequently, and whenever I would face them, there would be enough cover to avoid them. Like for example, on map 7, Arachnophobia, you kill all the arachnotrons, and you go towards exit, and this guy opens behind you. And you don't even have to kill him, you just go to the switch, and then a couple of feet ahead of you, you press the switch and you exit the level. So at no given point, it really felt like a challenging boss to deal with. Maybe towards the end of map 19, it could have been potentially a threat, but apparently it wasn't. Like, you have enough ammunition, you have enough cover, you just poke out, you shoot at the spider mastermind, you go behind the corner, and the spider mastermind goes down. He has a lot of health, but overall not enough challenge. One place where I did feel kind of threatened by him was map 12, Great Halls of Fire. In a particular case, you would just simply lower down the lift and you would have no option to go back up. And you happen to be in front of a spider mastermind. You cannot go around him, you cannot hide behind the corner. And you simply need to make sure to kill spider mastermind quickly enough. And of course, if you have a powerful weapon for it, you can do that job very quickly, but other than that, you either die because the spider mastermind can kill you very quickly, or you kill spider mastermind in that scenario very very quickly yourself because your weapon is just simply too tough for spider mastermind to handle. And in a lot of levels, these guys, they would go out against you very lonely. Like a lot of my encounters with spider masterminds, we are more or less one on one, like one me versus one spider mastermind. And there's a lot of potential being wasted because we are a lot of projectile based monsters. But the spider mastermind, unlike all of those monsters, it's capable to do hit scan attacks. And that's one good way to utilize the spider mastermind, which unfortunately wasn't used frequently enough in Hell Revealed. Like these monsters were rare, and they simply felt like a missed opportunity. Okay, we are moving forward. Okay, who is next? Keeper Demon. Again? Actually, I kind of enjoy the fact that Keeper Demon actually became sort of a recurring monster, like you would have to kill him frequently. I in particular enjoyed killing him in map 18, Hard Attack, because in that map we have four platforms and Keeper Demon could randomly teleport from one platform to another, so you needed to make sure that you hit him quickly enough before the Keeper Demon teleports away. And at any given moment, the Keeper Demon could teleport behind you and hit you with the rocket from behind. Other than that, there are some cases where the Keeper Demon would be used in too high numbers, like for example in map 28 in Top Hell, there was a room which had like 6 Keeper Demons. And the idea was like it was a reverse map 8 from Doom 2. Like there was one Baron of Hell and many Keeper Demons. But it was a very, very hugely wasted opportunity because what happened is that there was an invisible line which monsters couldn't pass. And that was the case with a lot of scenarios, like there were four platforms, each with two Keeper Demons, which couldn't escape the platforms because there were invisible lines preventing Keeper Demons from leaving. So there was no challenge because the numbers were there. Like Keeper Demons could chase you all around the map, but basically they couldn't leave their areas because of impassable lines, and those impassable lines greatly reduced the potential of a Keeper Demon to do any real damage to you. Because for example, where I remember encountering Keeper Demon fondly, it's map 22, resistance is futile. On that map, basically one wall fall down and like three Keeper Demons were set loose, and the good part was that there was no invisible lines blocking the Keeper Demons, so they could freely move around that island where you were. And that was actually a challenge, because when you can anticipate Keeper Demon to be at any given point, and you don't know where you are safe and where you are not safe. So it was like a very interesting scenario for me to overcome. Okay, moving forward. Ah, a hero. Bye. Anyways. Okay, time to drink. And time to move forward. So basically that was my review where I just talked about the monsters which I faced. And how exactly they affected the levels. And my thoughts whether they were used frequently enough, or they were underused or overused. So now it's time for me to move to the next part. Basically, maybe not necessarily part, because I intend this review to be one long video where I simply say all my ideas. So here we go. I just put up a notepad. Nothing basic, but. Well, basically just a couple words so I remember what I need to say. Because there's a lot to cover. So here we go. Well, Hell Revealed has a very interesting level structure. So basically, the first 10 or so levels are pretty easy. Not much challenge to have. And those levels suit as some sort of warming up period. Because at the time when Hell Revealed came, the concept of a slaughter map was still not being widely popular. There weren't really any super difficult levels out yet. So Hell Revealed was like a step in a direction where levels would become very difficult. So at the start, what Hell Revealed does, I guess it tries to kind of ease off the player. Yeah, at the start it's like easy, like you can overcome it very easily, but then it gradually goes up, and it might feel challenging to you, but actually the levels are easy, and what we are doing, we are preparing you for the really, really tough adventures. It's just the later two-thirds of the Hell Revealed. At map 11, the difficulty starts to ramp up, and suddenly you start to feel like you are in a huge challenge. And you might feel like giving up, but because you have been already through 10 levels, you think, wow, I've been through a lot. Well, what's next? I want to see what's next. Like, I've been through 10 levels. If these levels were thrown at you at first sight, if you were to go instead of map 1 to map 11, you might get discouraged from playing onwards. And maybe the other thing is that probably the map creators wanted to service a couple different groups of players. A group of players who wanted to a challenge, and a group of players who wanted the experience. And that's apparent even in difficulty settings, because usually Doom has three difficulty settings distinctive, and Hell Revealed basically has two distinctive settings. One setting, the ultra violence, where it's very, very difficult, and there's two thirds, later thirds. And I think I'm too young to die. And in that particular difficulty, all the difficulty is more or less the same. It much more feels like very slowly increasing, but the end it's still very easy. So I guess the creators of this megawad, they simply wanted to make sure that players understand the message about the time. But you don't simply have to play everything on ultra violence to get a full experience. Like ultra violence, like lately, even in current day, has become some sort of a normal difficulty where everybody plays on ultra violence, and as all the other difficulties are more or less ignored. So I guess the creators wanted to make a message that it's sometimes it might be a good idea to play on lower difficulties, and I guess they also wanted to encourage players to try very hard to complete levels on a hard difficulty. If they just want experience, they can go through it easy, and when they get curious and they try to go at harder difficulties and see how far they can go that way. So this way, that hard levels are not ignored, because if they were too difficult, people would miss them. So you have opportunity to have a challenge and an easy adventure in the same megawad. And the difference between those difficulties two is huge. It's like, wow, it's incredible. So if you're a new player to Doom series, like you're struggling with first person shooters, don't worry. In my playthrough, it seemed very hard maybe for you, but you can play it on two lowest difficulties, and it might be actually a pretty enjoyable experience for you. So now in the middle levels, like somewhere around map 15, you go into two secret levels. And that is one point where the difficulty kind of spikes up. Oh, it goes up. High. Because map 31, it's like up to that point, most of the levels felt kind of like normal levels. There were some monsters, like, but there were enough room to dodge them for most of the cases. In the secret levels, you suddenly are thrown at slaughter map type of levels. Like up to that point, I believe Hell revealed is like that particular megawad which started to pioneer the idea of slaughter map. And those secret levels are very difficult to overcome for an inexperienced player. So basically, they serve as an idea for player to give him a hint of what potentially is up for him coming in the future. Like for example, map 15 was pretty easy. Player might have thought that it might be like kind of challenging, like oh it's hard to beat it. But when you go to map 16, no not 16, but map 31, and in that map, all hell breaks loose. You're like in a slaughter map, basically. A lot of monsters coming at you. And what I really like in a particular map, it gives you a choice. You either decide to keep fighting on, you decide to keep challenging yourself and beat more monsters and go to a normal exit, or you take the easy way out and you go for the secret level. And like basically, when you go to it, and that's not very easy level. Like map 32 is one of the hardest levels available. So you go to map 32. And when you think maybe it was a mistake to go to that particular level. But anyways, those two maps, they are really challenging with secret levels. And I guess they spice things up for the players who are eager to get a real challenge. Like they decide to play from map 1 and they wanted to get to map 24 as quickly as possible, like to post-mortem. And the secret levels serve as a good place where people can relax. Some people, in order to relax, we need easy levels. And some people, to relax, we need a challenge, like a mindless challenge for them. Like they grind through it, like, oh, it's so challenging. Because whenever they will play an easier level, they will get bored. So sometimes it's a relaxation from challenge in Hell Revealed's case, and sometimes it's a relaxation from boredom. And in these levels, it is laid out pretty well. So, particular, I also like the idea that the last couple levels are not the hardest. The true challenge is somewhere around level 22, 23, 24, and maybe 26. And all the last couple levels, they are more like a showcase of a concept rather than a showcase of a difficulty. For type of player like me, like I'm sort of MLG kind of player who just goes around, and if I'm not challenged, I'm starting to make fun of all these monsters. So for me in particular, map 28, 29, 27, maybe bore fest mostly, but they make you sit on the edge. If you, for example, you have been to map 24, you have been to map 26, and you go into this map and think, wow, at any given moment something huge might happen. Some huge swarm on enemies, some slaughter map-esque situation might appear. And you're like on your edge. Any given moment could turn into a huge battle. So I really like that idea showcase in Temple of Fear, the map 29. That particular map is not difficult. It's easy. But you think it's the second to last map. There's probably some going to be something really difficult. And you anticipate for the entirety of the level a challenge to come. And your challenge doesn't come. And that is a pretty interesting concept to play some mind games. Because when you go to the last map, and you might be surprised again, because if every single map, one map after another, would be just as hard, then people might get a little bit bored, a little bit too used. Because if you make such easy breaks, the final map, like a final boss battle, it doesn't simply feel like a continuation of map 24, map 32. Map 22, map 26, that final boss feels like a boss. It feels like a fresh experience. Like you've been through three quite easy levels, and when you go to that level, and that level, like a huge battle. Like it's a huge fresh battle. Like you have rested from a challenge. You might need to refresh your senses, refresh your reaction, and it's like very good pacing in hell reveal levels, which I really enjoy. So now we've been through the structure of hell reveal and how difficult the progress is, more or less. Well, just showed you my monsters. So it's time for the architecture. So basically, Hell Revealed was released at the year 1997. Ancient times, actually, because if you think about games were coming at the time, they were mostly not as impressive as the games coming nowadays. The mods themselves, like the levels, player made levels for the Doom, they have gone miles from Hell Revealed. Now you can sometimes even think that current 8-day Doom, the original Doom levels made, they almost feel like AAA experience sometimes. And back in the day, basically Hell Revealed looked impressive. It was a technical achievement because, for example, in Map 24, there was just so much stuff that players weren't able to save. It was impossible to save. The only way to beat post-mortem was in one go. And probably that's why it was considered harder than Map 22 at the time. Basically, the creators of Hell Reveal really put a lot of effort. And we are kind of limited by the technology at the time. There were no source ports, basically. Maybe there was a source port called Doom 94, but... that's not a very powerful source spot, basically. So the main idea of map creators was to make sure that levels are fun to play through, that they are fun encounters, that there are a lot of monsters to deal with. And they also had some limited time, like for example, I believe the creation process was kind of halted by the fact that one of the creators was hospitalized for some time, I believe. But anyways, lag is a serious issue. If the game you play is too laggy, it's no fun. And the map creator wanted that to be a fun, challenging experience. So if you want to go high on the monster count, it means that you might need to make some changes on the level architecture to make sure that it does not become too laggy to deal with. And that is what was probably done. But still, the levels themselves are for the most part on par with Doom 2. Like, you go to Hell Revealed, you look back at Doom, and it doesn't feel like you go down in the quality. In fact, some of the levels might even feel even grander than actual original Doom. So at the time, the level quality was passable, and even now, the levels have got character to them. Go through these levels and it doesn't feel like you're going to blend the rooms, like to blend corridors, like you're going from one battle to another. It feels like these places have got distinct character, because okay, now I will say some examples myself. Arachnophobia, map 7. Whole map looks very interesting, like an interesting texture choice. It feels like otherworldly. But when you look at my minimap, the whole map represents a spider. Okay, that's a very interesting idea. Like, the developers of the map, they maybe didn't have enough resources to make something beautiful, but they did the best they could to make it interesting. I also like, in particular, the map City in the Skies. I thought it looked amazing. Yes, it looked more or less like a downtown or industrial zone from Doom 2, but overall it was a very, very refreshing experience, because those two aforementioned maps, they were very difficult. Even the city map in Plutonia 2, in original Plutonia was not as difficult. So go to quality, like at that time that city map looked like quality, it looked original. And it had very interesting idea of going around with it, but that it was in a dreamland, like it was Eden, like a heaven. It had interesting ideas, and the architecture itself almost feels like a city. Like at the time, probably it was impossible to make ultra-realistic city feel, because there'll be way too many lines required, so way too much lag produced, but still. Back in the day, that was a very beautiful megawatt to observe. For example, I also enjoyed the distinct look of Gates to Hell, map 15. It borrows some elements from Heretic, in particular from episode 2, map 8, boss fight in Heretic. But overall, it was a beautiful map. And I especially liked that it built up on the center idea, and it made outer ring. Basically, there's outer ring, and it is divided to 8 sections. And those say 8 sections, they lower down, and as you progress through a level, you suddenly become able to not simply use central teleporters to go around, but you're able to just simply walk around in the circle itself, the outer circle. And I like the idea. But it was simply compact spaces which you teleport in like a ninja, and you need to quickly dispatch all the monsters in it. And in that case, a level architecture indeed enchanted the experience of killing monsters. So, I also liked the idea of a descent. Like, yeah, it's a very basic room. Yeah, monsters start teleporting in. But what was original at that time, it was a time attack. It was not simply a platform, it was a platform lowering down. It was like a time attack. You fight all these monsters, they're coming for you. And you realize that it's coming for you. You don't know what's coming at the bottom. It's probably very difficult. And level does meet the expectation because it faces you with a mass amount of chain gunners at the bottom. So you think what kind of hell awaits you down below? What you're fighting in front of you is utterly hell. And you go down, and expectations are actually met. You are faced with a ton of chain gunners. And basically, the idea itself of lowering a lift where you are facing an endless fight is like a very good idea. And also in that particular level, it was also fun to see that the developers realized that players actually know how to strafe jump. Well, strafe run basically very fast that they don't fall to the ground. So they used it to create a group of ledges, a group of pillars for player to test out his strafing skills. Up to that point, I don't know any particular megawatt where it would be the case. So Hell Revealed also pioneered in the case of making strafe running become more mainstream. So I kinda enjoyed mostly harmful, and it might feel like a kind of basic level on some prospect because there's not much going on it. Like the 4 rooms of mostly harmful are copy pasted. That's the same room over and over again. Not only the room, but the monsters, the items, the weapons. But the key of that particular place is the center of the arena. Basically, in the center of the arena, what you would see is the 3D bridges. If you don't, haven't played original Doom, it is a 2.5D engine. Basically, you can make places differ in the height, but making things go underneath, like there's room above and there's room immediately below the room. That was impossible in the original Doom. I believe the creators used probably some modifications made in the final Doom to the engine to make some quite kind of bridge, which was pioneering at the time, like the pioneering technology. Like, for example, if you're on one platform, that bridge acts like a room which conjoins that bottom room. But if you're on above room and you want to go above the bridge, well, that bridge actually acts like a connection between those two upper rooms. So basically, it's not like a bridge is two separate rooms, but based on where you are standing, the bridge either becomes the ground for you or the bridge becomes bridge itself, basically on where you stand. So that was a very original concept in architecture at the time. And also it made some funny visuals too, because based on where you are looking,
a technology used to create a bridge, it would block a view of a level. So you would just look, wow, suddenly I'm not seeing parts of a level, wow, but when I walk around, I start seeing it. So I also enjoyed the visual look of map 16, the pad. Generally, it was a huge letdown because it was just mostly a spam of imps or a spam of barons, basically, and very little in between. So it was like a overall bad time while playing that level in particular, but I really liked where it was going. It was like giving life to sewer levels. It was like it felt grand. It didn't simply feel like some crappy place to be at. It felt like it was a grand, like grand structures. And I also liked the idea that there was a lot of damaging floor and you need to go around it in order to dodge all the projectiles. And in order to do it, you had to get a radiation suit. It was a very, very great idea, like for that map in particular. I also liked the siege, because when counters in the siege were mediocre, but the starting couple of rooms, they represent your home. And it, for a time being, it looked very realistic, probably the most detailed rooms in the Hell Revealed. You saw the toilet, you saw the kitchen, you saw bathroom, you saw a living room, you saw a TV, you saw your bed, you saw some books, you saw a carpet on the ground, it was such a cozy feeling. For that one particular couple of rooms, you felt like you're in your home. At that time, yes, right now homes look much, much better, but back in that time, it was like a step up in appearance of the rooms. It was a step up in the architecture. So I also enjoyed the afterlife. I have some negatives about it maybe, but I really liked the idea that you would be walking on a sky texture and it would feel like you are flying in the realm, like you are flying in the spirit realm. I also liked the idea that you would be given 100 hit points, like a soul sphere, and you would take a barrel to your face, like it would teleport inside a barrel, take away your hit points, it would take away your armor, and you would be propelled into a battle. It was like inevitable. You take damage, you take pain, you go down the hole, and you land in more pain, you land in front of many monsters. So it was a very interesting design choice, which I really enjoyed. Now, I also quite like the map 27, Cyberpunk. And it was the first time where I saw a maze made in a very interesting fashion, where the ceiling would be very high, and it would feel like you are not meant to be in this maze, because it is meant for something much, much bigger than you. It was a very interesting design choice for me to observe. So I guess time to spell out some unique ideas from my mouth. So I said I mentioned Arachnophobia. As I said, a beautiful map, especially considering its shape. Then we got Knockout. Overall, a basic map, if you think about it. I think the imp fight is the most memorable imp fight of all time from all the megawads. I have never had this much joy killing the imps in that particular map. But that's not a standout idea. A standout idea was that at the start, you would be given next to no ammunition, you would be given a berserk pack, and you need to punch your way out. You need to punch all the monsters, and you need to go more or less pacifist route, because if you try other options, you simply run out of ammo. Well, it was kind of a missed opportunity, actually, because the previous level just gave way too much ammunition for you. And yes, I will briefly mention this. Or not, I won't mention that, actually. But anyways, you start well with a lot of ammunition for yourself and just move forward. move forward, and you just blast all the monsters. We just keep coming at you and you keep blasting them. Most of them are weaklings, and you already at that point have good weapons. So you just blast them off. And yes, you finish the level with the next no ammo. But it was possible to complete the whole level without being forced to go to melee combat. So that's like something. If you want to experience the map knockout in its full glory, go to that particular map with Pistol Start. And I think you won't regret, because it will make you consider every single shot of yours. And it also make you consider very careful how you approach your monsters and which of them you will punch. And which of them will just simply shoot you dead. Okay. So I also kind of enjoyed the Great Halls of Fire. It had Baron fight in it. Like one Baron at a time. 12 Barons total. Like one kill one Baron, when you kill another, when you kill another, when you kill another. And yes, room is huge for that. For one Baron, that room is gigantic. So it was like, well, yay, Nick, idea on the paper. But the difficulty of the idea is so. Like, I also liked the one idea where I saw Pain Elemental stuck into a wall behind another line. Like, and that line was a texture, but you could shoot through the texture. And the texture was a texture of a fireplace. So you shoot at the fireplace and you hear Pain Elemental screaming. So that was like a nice touch for me. And I also mentioned that the Great Halls of Fire also have that one encounter with Spider Mastermind. You just fall down into a kind of corridor and you need to kill the Spider Mastermind to go through. So that was another interesting and original idea at that time. So I already mentioned it, but Hellgate's pretty interesting concept of a level, I'd say. As I said, but teleporters, the idea to go around in a circle, like, be brilliant. Also, a very good idea that in order to go to super secret level, you need to find all the 3 secrets. Like, you don't simply go to secret level, you need to show that you're professional at finding secrets. And the first secret you find it, you need to shoot the wall in front of you, and you can only do it in the very, very start. And you're in pitch black room, and there's no hint that you need to do it. If you want to get the hint, you actually needed to read the extra files for Hell Revealed, where the developers would give a description for each of the level. So in order to reach secret levels, you actually needed to prove that you spent that time going immersed with the lore of Hell Revealed, immersed with the storytelling of each level, what it stands about. That's a pretty interesting idea after all. Granted, secret levels are optional, but if you want to get to that optional stuff, you need to go some steps beyond. Yeah. Okay, so Descent, as I said, brilliant level. Like I'm mentioning them again and again, but just my ideas that you would think about them. They were original, they were beautifully made, like very beautiful concepts, and they just were a word of all my mentions, because that those ideas being executed, they were original at that time. They were pushing the Doom community, Doom map making community, to the next level. So I also very enjoyed some ideas presented in the Hard Attack. Basically, well, it was a grind fest. I really, really, in the end, was worn down by that level, but it had some great ideas. I cannot deny that. That part where I would need to kill a Cyber Demon teleporting in between 4 pillars, which I have already mentioned. That part is like a gold burned in ashes. Like, it was a very interesting idea. I also liked the idea where you go to one secret place and all the monsters start teleporting in, but they don't simply teleport in. As they walk around, they teleport also, so they simply start moving in front through the stairs in that part, And on each step, they teleport on each new step. So it makes like an interesting effect you observe. I also like that the same Kyber Demon which you fight in the teleporting rooms, I believe, you start in the very first room with him. And you just see his back turned against you and you think, wow, how am I dealing with it? And what happens? You touch the Kyber Demon, you poke it with your fingers or with your gunshot. And the Kyber Demon moves a bit and he teleports out. So it's like a rock removed from your heart. And then for some time you still hear the Kyber Demon as he is moving somewhere nearby in some nearby rooms. And you just hear his footsteps. So that's a very interesting concept to increase the tension. It's just such a shame that that particular map turned into such a huge grind. Okay, I enjoyed map 19. It was a map Everything Dies. It gives you all the health, all the armor, and all the weapons and ammunition at the start, I believe. And that's all you have. And all you need to do is just go to the end of a level. It was kind of missed opportunity in a sense. And you have way more ammo than you would necessarily need because you start with max ammo. But the amount of monsters to deal with is not big enough to push you to the limit where you are afraid to go without no ammo at all. Also, even the health is not necessary because in that case, I went to that level and the megasphere was replaced with another item. So I didn't have any new health and I still beat the level. Just a testament to showcase that the level is not difficult enough. It tries to push interesting concept and I greatly enjoyed it because technically speaking, you got all that ammo because there was a copy of you hidden like a ragdoll in one room and a lift raised all that stuff to that ragdoll and ragdoll got it and you got it in return. Very interesting idea. But it was a letdown because, easy, where interesting ideas get easy executions where you get kind of bored. First, you are excited, you are hyped. Will this be a difficult level? Wow, this will be a challenge probably. Look at all this health and ammo I get. When it turns into something easy, apparently. Well, if you're going blind to that level, you might feel very confident at the first, but maybe I'll get more health later, but basically at any given point did they face an unavoidable damage. Like basically, you could finish the entire level on one hit point and without much worry. That's how easy it was actually. Okay, moving forward. I liked Judgment Day. It had some interesting ideas. I liked that it tried to utilize Kyber Demon as a statue. You walk by the Kyber Demon at first and it just stands there and it does nothing. But when you get the key, you walk back and Kyber Demon is awake. That statue became alive. That's a very interesting idea. I also liked the use of some of the invisible steps. It made some keys look like they are in the middle of nowhere. And it was an interesting encounter with the Barons of Hell in one arena, which was supposed to work like the Barons of Hell. So you just walk, they cross the line, and they teleport to the back of the room, and they move forward. They cross another line, and they back teleport to another place. Idea was that those barons do not escape the room. What happened? I believe that all those barons were being teleported to the same place. So a monster cannot telefrag another monster. So one baron teleports to his supposed destination. And all the other barons cross that other line and just leave the arena. Because the level was quite poorly designed in my opinion, because it's simply one baron is left in the arena walking back and forth while not being a threat at all, and all of the other barons leave the room, making all that interesting concept being wasted in my opinion. So the next map is Afterlife. I already said that it looked very amazing, but I also liked one room in it, it was looked like the chess board, like all the monsters are replaced, well, all the chess pieces are replaced with monsters, and it's all happening on the chessboard. And the idea is that you walk around the chessboard and you see a double-barreled shotgun, and you take the shotgun. You think you will take the shotgun, but instead you don't take the shotgun. You get teleported to the middle of the chessboard and you need to kill all the monsters. And also, it's even impossible to get the double-barreled shotgun in that room. So I tried very hard as I humanly could, I couldn't get my shotgun. So it was like a troll move by the map creators. But at least you got single-barreled shotgun in that level, I believe. And also like the idea that towards the end, it would happen that... okay, wait a second. The sun was getting too extreme. But anyways, near the end of that arena, one of the choices were paths to go. As you flip some switches, invisible monsters would spawn. They could go through walls. You could shoot them, but you don't harm them. And that was an interesting idea. You have a lot of stuff to battle, a lot of actual monsters to kill. But in the end, you need to dodge all the monsters which you cannot kill, and those monsters are like ghosts. And they are like ghosts which haunt you. And that gives you an idea. You've been through so many levels up to that point. You killed a lot of monsters, and it seems like you're now in the heaven, at least in the hell of heaven of some sort, where all the dead monsters go. And now the dead want to extract a revenge on you. And that was a very good idea, very original. I have not seen that used again. Like, it was like Hell Reveal was ahead of its time, with its concepts being portrayed in it. So now we move forward. I haven't. There's a level called Cyberpunk. I told you that it has some interesting mazes in it. Huge mazes. And I like the idea that they were populated with cyber demons. We're still walking all the huge maze, and at any given moment a cyber demon might appear behind the corner, and navigating that maze was pretty difficult and actually a challenge. You felt the tension while going through that maze. Unfortunately, it was not fully utilized, because at the very start of the maze there are some impassable lines for the cyber demons, so you hide behind the corner, hide behind that line, and you just shoot and kill the cyber demons that way with total ease, and then you just travel the empty maze like that. But still, it has to be said that the idea of such maze was very original and groundbreaking. So the last is Temple of Fear. It had a very interesting pentagram made in it. The developers say it was made with a very, very precise math. The other interesting idea in it was the secret. Basically, the autumn F was disabled for the corridors of the secret. It was pitch black, and it had some pits in which you would fall and you couldn't escape them. So that was like, wow, that's very hard to go through. What's the reward? And the reward is that you get all the ammo and you got full health and armor. So it's like one of the most unfair secrets to actually get to the end. But in the end, it's the most rewarding secret, because you think, I'm going to all this stuff. Is it worth it in the end? And yes, it gives you everything you could have been imagining yourself. And that, like, you couldn't use the map to pass the maze. You actually needed to use your instincts, like, to use your thoughts to think. Maybe you needed to look at the auto map to see whenever you would stop moving on the map. But you still, you need to dedicate yourself, like, you need to draw the corridors in your head. So, now we are moving forward. So, I had some fun encounters, like, wow, great stuff overall. So, some of the fun encounters I had was into the gates. That early teleporter is kind of fun. Because you could try to avoid killing the monsters and try to go to the very end of that level, and then fire button, not fire button, fire gun, and all the monsters start to teleport into the same room. And if you have infighting enabled, all the monsters start killing themselves. Like the demons turn onto imps, imps turn onto shotgunners turn onto zombies. Like all the hell breaks loose, and it's like fun to observe for me. Arachnophobia was also one of my favorites, because in that case I can really show some lead dodging skills. If you watch that part, I really showed like how real professionals dodge Arachnotron. I like move to the side and move to the other, and I just move in between the fireballs of the Arachnotron. It was like a very great, like it's a short level, short and sweet, and gives you a very original encounter. I'm not sure if it was ever done before up to Hell Revealed. I also had some fun in Last Look at Eden. As I said, the glorious battle of the Mancubi. Also, the very start of the level is like tense. And my favorite part is like one of the cage fights. You just go into that cage, and the door closes. A lot of monsters open up. And what you need to do is you need to survive long enough for the door to open up so that you go to safety and you would kill those monsters. So it was like pushing you to the limit. There was a lot of stuff trying to kill you. Chain gunners and even legit monsters. And you was in a confined space, like the monsters were shooting at you from all eight directions, basically. And you could only walk around. And if you don't kill all the chain gunners, like there was a lot of them, you would die very quickly. So it was a test on how quickly you can kill all the chain gunners. And then a test, how long can you survive all the remaining monsters throwing projectiles at you until you are free to leave that cage and get back on the ammo, get back on the health, and etc. It was one of the most tense moments. It was a tense moment done right. Because as I mentioned before, in the map Ascending the Stars, it was used poorly, where you just face a ton of chain gunners and that's it. And all the fun is gone. It will just pepper you. You don't have a choice. You are either you spam your BFG or its replacement, and you kill the monsters that way as quickly as possible, or you die. And that Last Look at Eden actually provide a fun timed survival experience in that cage for me. So I also had a lot of fun in City of the Clouds. If you watch that part, I'm like. And as I'm or whatever, I just roam the streets, poke some shots here and there. When I go to a completely different part of that level and then poke some shots in that part, it's like a test to see how much damage can you do until the situation becomes unbearable and it's too late for you to leave. Basically, it was fun challenge, like. It was like a cat and mouse, like all the monsters are trying to come on you. And they are very powerful, but you have an advantage of having faster feet. So it's like the real challenge is to move intelligently. And I really enjoyed that concept. So I also liked the descent for all the mentioned reasons, like great fun to be in a lift and have not simply wait for the lift to end. It's journey, but in the meantime, be entertained by all those monsters. As I said, that was a very great concept, and it was like a very interesting challenge for me, because it was a challenge on how quickly can I kill the monsters quick enough, can I exterminate them quick enough before it gets out of control, and it was great fun for me. And then I also had a lot of fun in Mostly Harmful. Yes, it was a stressful level, but it was a good kind of stressful level, like. A lot of things, like you know your time is timed. You need to be quick, you need to rush through this. There's just a lot of stuff to deal with. Some of it might be grinding, but grinding gets a different completely meaning if you know that you need to hurry. Grinding then becomes actually some sort of fun because you need to kill that Baron. The question is not whether you will kill that Baron. The question is will you kill him quickly enough? And that is actually a fun part. And I guess I'm kind of biased on those maps because they are really difficult. The harder the map, the more likely it is that I will enjoy it. unless it's like unfair. If a map is fair but difficult, there's very good chance that I will join because I really like to be pushed myself to the limit. I get a chance to overcome myself, to overcome my limits, to become a player, to become better player in the process, like to push myself, like to overcome a huge challenge, the kind of challenge I've never faced before. And those are the kinds of maps which really entertain me. And same applies to maps, resistance is futile. If you watch that part, I really had a lot of joy while playing it. It was just a good old slaughter map. Like, oh, all the hell is going at you. There's a ton of monsters coming at you. Will you kill them quick enough? Will you survive? And there's too many monsters to dodge them efficiently, so strafe running is not an option. You will have to perform and showcase some other types of skills. And that's like really putting players into uncomfortable positions where they really need to use some alternative strategies, and I really like that aspect. So now it comes post-mortem, like the last map which I really enjoyed. That mancubi, those two pillars of mancubi really dragged the fun down, but it's still an enjoyable level. That pain elemental encounter which I talked about previously, it really made for it. And it's also like, I really like the beginning of that level because it's actually a spam of cacodemon trying to chase you. I think the only case where cacodemons are being used as an actual threat. And I really like that all the action is happening on the ground, and the ground is damaging floor, so you have limited amount of radiation suits. So your time is running out. You need to be quick enough to kill enough monsters that you would be able to go back on the starting platform and actually make progress from it. Which means to kill all the cacodemons and to kill all the starting revenants around your starting platform. So it was a kind of challenge, and it was like a very original kind of challenge. Like, I've never dealt with that kind of situation where you need to rely on radiation suits, which are very limited, and like you need to also move around very quickly. Like, it was like moving around in a city in the clouds, but it was on steroids. It was like taking to the next level beyond it. It was a great level, like. Now, some time to say some disappointments, at least for me personally. Okay, I will drink some water. I will need some energy for this one. Yeah, I will really need this energy. So basically, here we go. Number one, the jail. Map 8 or 9, maybe 8, no, maybe 7, I don't know, but the jail. That map had like optional rooms, which just had a ton of monsters hidden in the cages, and it had no pickups to get, so it was like a pointless adventure to those rooms. Yeah, I get it, it's the jail. Yeah, jail. Yeah, monsters in cages. Yeah, monsters who cannot chase you, but apparently nothing, no reward. You don't even have to go next to those cages. So, what's the point of going there? It's like you demotivate player from exploration. It's like playing some mind games and players who want to speedrun this in a 100% ultra violence category, like something. And we got this beauty like underground base, but it was supposed to be a difficult map. It wasn't. You were given plenty of opportunities to kill all the challenging monsters from the cover, so by default that's like a very bad map design, because at any given time I could kill anything I want from a corner. There's also a huge spam of invisible lines preventing monsters from crossing them. And it had a BFG room. It could have been great. It could have been amazing. What happens? You can hide behind the corner, and the monsters cannot chase you to that corner. You can forfeit the room at any time you want to. Oh yeah, all the fun taken away. And that arena had the encounters, had the monsters to challenge you. Unfortunately, you could simply avoid them, so therefore all the fun that had been gone. Fortunately, really unfortunate. when axes were paired. If you watch my part on it, I think it probably is self-explanatory for you. You got your fort. Your fort has a lift. And in your fort, we are a couple of hundred of barons, knights, and revenants. They are no challenge to you. All they do is go to that one lift, stay on the lift, you lower the lift, you kill the monsters. The lift goes up. When new monsters go on the lift, when the lift goes down, you kill those monsters. Lift goes up, lift goes down, monsters go and leave and go and leave. And you do it dozens of times, and it's like, oh, it's so grind, it was grindy. Like, it was such a huge grind fest, but it was really like taking grinding to the next level. Really. I didn't like that part, and that part single-handedly reduced all the fun I could have had in that level. I also didn't enjoy Judgment Day. Mostly, as I said, it had a failed part with the teleporting barons. And it also, I didn't like that near the end of the level, you can just simply leave and avoid the arena battle. Like, you even could have taken all that ammo designed from a battle in that arena and just left. You could have taken all the health, all the stuff, and you just left. I am much more of a fan of players being forced to at least sometimes engage in a challenge. And in Judgment Day, you could simply run past most of the challenge. Like, there was, I think, only one case where you really had to kill the monsters to proceed forward. And maybe one Kyber Demon fight, where you fight one single Kyber Demon to get to the teleporter. But otherwise, it wasn't a very interesting level. It had some funny textures. Architecture was maybe okay, but the battles themselves weren't very memorable, and you were given opportunities to simply run away from most of them. So, I also didn't like ascending the stars. That level brought grinding, which was almost on par with Heart Attack. Well, especially in the final room. There's like 30 archways on the platforms into the two sides of the room. You open the door, you poke some shots in those archways, and you go back into your room. And the worst part is that it is a teleporter behind you. So you teleport back to some random place and you need to go walk a lot of stuff, like walk a quite a distance to get back to that same door. And you rinse and repeat that process for a long period of time. Also, that Oxenium of Stars also had some grinding with barons, some grinding with Kyber Demons. Both of them were stuck behind the impassable line, so whenever I get into that scenario, it really, really destroys a lot of fun for me. When I just have to go to sponges, like from damage, through those damaged sponges, and I know that they cannot do crap to me, they cannot do anything to me. It's just a question of how much time does it take to go through this room, and it's not fun for me. So the last one is Top Hell. Basically, it had tough monsters, but it gave so much room that it didn't matter how many about those tough monsters, because you had too much room to dodge them. So it took all the fun away just because of that. Like, it had barons, it had Kyber Demons, there was just so much room, but it wasn't really fun to engage it, and especially as I mentioned before. A place where I had to deal with six Kyber Demons behind invisible line. Yeah, imagine like one Kyber Demon has 4,000 health. Six Kyber Demons have 24,000 health. Imagine me dealing with that. Imagine how much time that grinding took out of me. So, time for some quick observations now. So, if you didn't realize already, some standout levels difficulty-wise for me was map 24, map 22, map 22, map 31. And those particular levels, oh yeah, map 32. Those five levels are the standoffs, considering the difficulty. If you're going to play with megawad, if you didn't watch my playthrough and you want to go in blind, keep in mind, if you feel it's difficulty, if you feel you're getting challenged, don't worry, my friend. It's easy, it's going to get tenfold harder. Just keep waiting for map 22, 23, 24, 26, 32. I mean, if you are not experienced player and you want to save some nerves, I recommend you to be on lower difficulty and to skip secret levels. But of course, if you want to push yourself to the next level and you're not afraid to have some nervous breakdowns or to save scum a lot, sure. But trust me, most are standoff difficult levels. If you only play original Doom, the term difficulty will gain a new meaning for you, so keep that in mind. So overall, this both technology wise, monster and counter wise, I think it was a step up from original Doom, but it still had a lot of problems, which were thankfully fixed in the upcoming megawads by different people. Hell Reveal was a huge inspiration for WAD authors. Like, I think Hell Reveal influenced Aiden Vendetta and its successors. Hell Reveal was so popular that it even spawned a sequel made by a different team of people, Hell Reveal 2. And maybe in some future date I might cover it, but right now I'll probably be covering something else. There were some traps in Hell Reveal, but they weren't spammed. There was just a couple uses of them. I believe only like map 6 had a crusher, which I remember myself. I don't know about traps in other levels. There were some traps in map 29 secret area. But overall, player killing traps are very rare in Hell Reveal. So if you don't like dealing with that unfairness, you are safe in Hell Revealed. The secrets themselves, some of them are easy to find, some of them are harder. But if you look hard enough for them, you should be able to find all of them. I myself found most of the secrets and I didn't consult with any guide in order to do it. So the secrets which you see myself discovering, they are all discovered thanks to me. Thanks to my own efforts. So most of the secrets are easy to find. Maybe there are some difficult ones, but overall, well, if you are having difficulty and you think maybe you should backtrack and find some secrets, yeah, don't feel despair. There's a good chance that you'll find the secrets when you are in need of them. Also, in map 31, at the very start, look very, very well for the 4 secrets before falling down the lift. You'll find the necessary ammo to deal with the next encounter with monsters. It's very important to tell you if you are playing that map from pistol start. Otherwise, it will be impossible without those 4 secrets being found. I also enjoyed the theme of some of the levels. I really liked the theme going around the heaven levels. Like, up to that point, I don't know if there were any heaven levels. But maps from map 13 to map 15, maybe map 16, no, maybe map 17 and 19 and 22, they had very interesting texture for the sky, and they had a vibe which went in heaven, and it was a very original dramatic departure for Elder Wild, another one map. The episodes have very distinctive style. And they feel competitively made. It seems like you're really going through places. It doesn't feel like you're randomly teleporting from one level to another. There's the one theme connecting each of the levels, at least in the episodes. Like the first 10 levels of a team, like middle 10 levels of a team, and the last 10 levels of a team. You should be able to play Hell Revealed with ease right now. We have some sore spots. Like, for example, I was able to record it, and all those huge amounts of monsters are no longer really a problem. I recommend you to Google and research Zandronum. I recommend you to research GZ Doom. Research some mods to increase your fun. And it shouldn't be too laggy for your computer, even if it's a potato style computer. I remember having a laptop with only 2 GB of RAM, like 15 years old laptop, and even it handled hell revealed with ease. And I'm certain that even weaker machines can handle hell revealed with ease. Maybe even like a half gigabyte RAM might be enough for hell revealed. I'm pretty sure of that. So now we are moving forward. Now, hell revealed is pretty popular and it's gaining a lot of popularity. If you're the first playthrough you saw, just search for hell revealed, you will find a lot of people have made hell revealed videos, and hell revealed is regarded as one of the most famous early slaughter maps, and a lot of people really want to experience it and to show to other players. So there's a lot of material made about hell revealed. Also, search some search engines. There are some blogs which review levels. So, yeah, blog. There's a blog there you go, and you even find a review for each single level of Hell Revealed and for a whole megawad. I didn't read it. My thoughts are original. So if you want to even have more ideas about Hell Revealed, find that blog. I think I will leave a link below in my description. Hell Revealed had some custom art. It wasn't a huge deal, only in some places, but it was interesting nonetheless. I really enjoyed it whenever I would see that art. I guess most of it was used for church windows, as far as I remember. But there might be some other cases of art being used too. I also it, Hell Revealed had a soundtrack, but I muted it. Because all the soundtrack comes from different games, maybe from original Doom. I don't know what is copyrighted, what is not. Basically, to my knowledge, a lot of that music comes from Rise of Triads, just to give you an idea of what music you should expect. And even through a lot of time has passed since Hell Revealed was made, I think I still recommend you to play it. It's a lot of fun to be had here. Like, yeah, architecture maybe doesn't hold up. But the gameplay itself still has a lot of good ideas. Granted, some maps are grindy, but the more maps which are not grindy are a lot of fun to go through. Okay, now I'll make a short overview of Serious Sam. Well, it's a very basic mod. If you played Serious Sam, it basically brings in all the weapons from Serious Sam, the original one. So basically, some things to note. BFG replacement is cannon, and cannon is explodes very heavily, so you don't want to be next to your cannonball. And also your projectiles, especially your rockets, except for the cannonball. The rockets can be shot mid-air, so you need to take care of it. For example, imp fireballs, chain gunner shots, they can blow up your rockets, so whenever you aim your rockets, aim them at the feet of your enemies so they don't collide with the projectile. Also, it has grenade launcher, and the grenade launcher is very fun to use if you spam it very quickly. It can bounce from the walls and can be used as strategic weapon, but if you want to spam quick explosives, you just tap your fire button very quickly and you spam a lot of grenades in a very short span of time. Also, from my experience, both Tommy gun and mini gun feel the same, so I guess I missed the opportunity. And then there's a napalm launcher, so flamethrower. That weapon has short range, so keep it in mind. There's also a sniper rifle, and if you don't use it while scoped, it will do very little damage, so you want to use it efficiently. Use your scoped view. There's also Serious Bomb. It's a real item and it kills all the monsters inside, so it's very useful in the dire situations. So some of the weapons are randomized. Like for example, a chain gun can be either replaced with Tommy gun or a minigun. That's not much of a difference. The real difference comes from plasma rifle replacements. It can be either laser gun, flamethrower, or sniper rifle. And all the ammo is randomized too, so basically if he has one plasma rifle, you will only get one third of a weaponry for it. And you will only get as a result only one third of ammo. For example, you got laser gun. So all that sniper and flamethrower ammo will just lie in the level useless, so keep it in mind. That's a good reason why I use this mod on Hell Revealed, because the first 10 levels are easy. So I had my opportunities to get all of my arsenal before hard levels. Going to pre-prom pistol start and hard levels might leave you to serious ammo shortages on a cell type of ammunition, so keep that in mind if you play Hell Revealed, like, or any other megawad with serious ammo weapon mod. It might take you a lot of levels until you assemble complete your arsenal. Sometimes you might get unlucky, for many levels in a row you might be getting the same weapon, so keep that in mind. Some of the items are replaced. Most of the time they are more or less the same thing which we are replacing, but I want to let you know that megaspheres, brown ball which gives you 200 hit points, 200 armor, is replaced with random stuff. So you may be you might have less ammo, no, not ammo, less health and less armor, so keep that in mind. It might make you have some difficulty on some of the levels, but it's usually not a big deal. Also, ammo I believe is kind of fairly balanced, but I believe if you have all the weapons already, the chances are that you might be getting a little bit more ammo than you should. Maybe a little increase in ammo capacity, like you might have more ammo than usual, but overall, ammo wise, it is more or less balanced, so don't worry about running in bathing in the rivers of ammunition. So I believe Doom and CRSM clash well. At least it felt like it clashes well, like I didn't feel the necessity to face CRSM monsters or to use Doom weaponry. Overall, CRSM is a good pick for Doom, especially for slaughter maps, because they have a good... they have a design of mostly of arena, and CRSM is arena shooter, so they combine pretty well. And overall, I believe CRSM has potential to make games harder, but overall, if you got all the weapons, you have much more options to kill your opponents. It's much easier to snipe with sniper rifle, it's much easier to deal with swarms of enemies with flamethrower, like cannonball and grenade launcher can be used to kill monsters through the corner. Yes, there's no BFG, maybe that's one minus, but overall, the weapons are much, much more powerful than other, and maybe even some of the weapons have bigger ammo capacities. Like, for example, in the original Doom, I believe you have a 400 bullet limit. In the CRSM Doom, you have 500 bullet limit, and also you already start with max ammo already. For example, in Doom, you start with 200 max clips, like ammo, and in CRSM we always start with all 500 bullets limit from the get go. So overall, also it might be a challenge, but if you use rocket launcher, it's much easier to destroy your rocket mid-air and take damage that way. So yes, if you think about it, the guns are overall more powerful. It might be easier most of the time, but we have some side notes. But it might be sometimes harder, but overall I believe it makes the game just a little bit easier. Especially when you consider a serious bomb. That thing is 10 times more powerful than BMG. It destroys everything inside. So if you want to have a fair challenge, maybe just use a serious bomb as a last resort weapon. So multiplayer didn't work very well for me. For example, Zandronum bots, which I used, they default to a knife. And they think they can beat me with a knife. They just keep slashing the mid-air. Oh, with their knives, their little knives. And I only go into guns if we are lucky. So on Zandronimo, on some of my playthroughs, what I did is make it when the bots drop their weapon on that, so that way there was some knives lying around, a lot of them. But there was also some actual weapons lying around, so there was more action because bots would pick up their weapon and use it. Also, a lot of game modes are very hard to support on Zandronimo because originally Zero Sum was meant for Jinzu Doom. It was only possible in Zandronimo because Zandronimo advanced a lot of recently. It got a lot of functionality new. So, talking about game modes, it does not support Buckshot mode, it does not support Insta Game mode. You can use Buckshot to kind of make yourself play Last Man Standing without the nuclear bombs. That's that. If we are using regular Last Man Standing, everybody will have nukes and things will go flying and then we will die. It's just a question of seconds until you die, actually. For example, like you have 3 seconds of starting in vulnerability. 3 seconds pass, 1 more second passes, and now you're dead. Like basically, in less than half a minute, I would waste 5 lives. Thanks to those bombs, they are so powerful. So, the Hell Reveal maps themselves were pretty suitable. At least those which I played. If you want to have some multiplayer games, play map 1, map 2, map 30, I think maybe map 25 and maybe map 31. Those maps are small, compacted, and they can have a lot of fun for you to enjoy. Maybe map 14 could be fun too to play through, but our maps might not be as fun. In particular, for example, map 19, it has like a starting ledge. You drop down the ledge and you cannot come back to it. So when playing maps, keep in mind that some maps might be very straightforward and there might be maps with no return point. Like if you go far enough, you cannot go to the very beginning of the level. So there's particular levels, like for example map 11, map 19, they are not very suitable for multiplayer. So if you want multiplayer, yeah, Hell Reveal will provide you, but just keep in mind that most of the maps are not suited for it, but there are just a couple maps in case you really want to have some multiplayer, to kill some people on Hell Reveal, to show them how the real levels looked in 1997, how the good old days looked like. Also, I probably saw it, but map 2 has a complete unique level. Unique arena just made for the damage. It's basically more or less the same as map 25. But you might, if you want to see some original content, check map 2 in the multiplayer mode. So I tried to play cooperative, but Zandronimo didn't support it. I wanted to make some extra parts and I play cooperative, I try to speedrun and I want to see just how many extra monsters the map creator cram in. Because they were bragging that they put at least one Kyber Demon per level. So basically there will be Kyber Demon on map 1, Kyber Demon on map 2 and so on. And there will be a lot of extra monsters, but on Zandronimo if I try to play by myself, it says that I'm in cooperative mode, but the monster ammo stays the same. And if I try to play with some bot as my teammate, my Zandronimo just crashes. So I don't know how cooperative works on Hell Reveal, but I believe it's just more of the same. But if you want to have some challenge, maybe find a way to play cooperative by yourself and activate all those extra monsters. Or if you want to have fun and you want to play Hell Reveal with many players, don't worry. Those extra monsters will make sure that it's not too easy for you. So if you want to experience something similar to Hell Reveal, I recommend you to check out Hell Reveal. Hell Reveal 2, I meant. Alien Vendetta. Maybe Scythe series, Scythe 1, Scythe 2. Maybe Hellbound. Hellbound is already a huge step up in architecture. Well, there's a lot of maps, like a lot of words for you to check out, basically. And maybe start searching slaughter map if you want something with a lot of monsters to encounter. And for if you like to play Sierra Sam and Doom, there's not that many options. Basically, this one is one of the only options to play through. Check a guy named Icarus Lives and his Doom mod series and search for Sierra Sam next encounter. There's a mod for Sierra Sam which has 3 levels with Sierra Sam weapons and Sierra Sam monsters too. But it's only 3 levels. Maybe there's some arena type extra map gameplay for you, like defend your base type of gameplay. And overall, there's not very much content. I might cover it up in some later Doom series, but overall, there's next to no content for Sierra Sam. So basically, this mod for Sierra Sam weapons is your standalone mod if you want to experience Sierra Sam in Doom. So basically, that was my full review. It might have taken some time, but I wanted to make it all in one video and to deliver it to you in one video. If you haven't watched my Hell Review series, my all the parts of this video, this might serve as a good idea what you might experience in your blind run through Hell Reveal. And if you are not convinced, if you were not convinced about playing Hell Reveal before, maybe this video help you to make the decision whether to play Hell Reveal or not. So when I decide to make next series, I will make an announcement for them. But right now, for some time probably there will be no gaming videos. So anyways, well, we have some more serious topics to cover and I will make videos about them soon. But anyways, if you liked what you saw, don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, like hit the bell, and I really appreciate your feedback. My playthrough of Hell Revealed and this review itself, it was all a work of love. Like I really enjoy my series. The series like Hell Revealed is one of my favorite megawads. Playing through it meant a lot of me. Like I have many playthroughs of it in the past, a lot of memorable moments for myself, which I only keep for myself because I didn't record them at the time. So this time, at least I made some good recordings. Like you could see my experience rate. You can see sometimes I had fun, sometimes I was pretty angry at the grinding. But overall, it was a worthy journey for me. And oh, never mind. There's some people going into my room. I just wanted to let them know. But they would stay silent, so it might have seemed like some sort of salute. But I'm not a Nazi. Sorry if you saw that. Sorry if that offended you. Well, but anyways, thank you for watching. And if you want to see more content where I make a series, gaming series, leave me some suggestions. It will take me a lot of time to go to come to that stuff because there will be some sort of a break for me. But in some future I will certainly go back to gaming, and if you leave any suggestions for me to go through, I will consider them greatly. So thank you for watching and bye.